Good morning, all of you. I'm a medical doctor, an anesthesiologist. My medical course, during MBBS course, I was just a normal average student, just entered into the medical school, want to pass out all the exams, and enter into a post-graduation, whatever I get through the entrance examination, do the post-graduation, start working in a medical college or a private hospital or in any other private clinics, and happily married and have kids and lead my life. That's what I did. In MBBS, I passed out. I got through the entrance examination. I got MD anesthesia. When I entered into anesthesia, the problem with anesthesia is, you all know what is anesthesia. Anesthesia is, you make the patient completely pain-free during surgery and give comfort to the surgeon and also to the patient. And one more beautiful thing about anesthesia is, during the anesthesia, we stop the breathing of the patient completely. We paralyze the diaphragm, we paralyze all the muscles of respiration, and whenever the surgery is over, we again get up the patient from the anesthesia and send the patient to recovery room from there to outside the hospital. But the problem with anesthesia is you never get recognized as a doctor because we are in the operation theater with the caps and masks. We never get recognized by the patient that, he's the doctor who has given anesthesia. He is the doctor who treated me in the surgery, participated in the surgery. That was there always with all the anesthetists around the world. They don't get recognition. Whenever I see a patient in a shopping mall or a cinema theater or in a temple, they don't recognize us. That was the problem with anesthesia. Okay, then I was happy with that. I know that there is a problem, but one day, in my practice, something has happened. I was called upon by an orthopedic surgeon to give anesthesia for a knee replacement surgery. So knee replacement surgery is done for a knee osteoarthritis where in between the knee joint there is a cartilage which wears off and both the bones get rubbed against each other. So what they do is they remove the knee joint and put a new knee joint with a metal and cement. So I started giving anesthesia. Everything was fine. Anesthetists should be very, very aware of the things that anything can go wrong and you have seconds to revive the patient. That is the challenge of anesthesia. So everything is good and they cut the bones open. They wanted to implant that metal into the cut bone end. To attach that, they use a cement. So they started putting that implant onto the cut end of the bone with the help of the cement. Suddenly I saw the patient slowly become drowsy, not responding, and the pulse is coming down, and patient is not breathing at all. So I got alerted, and immediately I know that there is a reaction of the cement to the body. There is an anaphylactic reaction. So immediately, anesthetist, we know the drill, what to do. So we need to see that the breathing comes back again, or we need to give oxygen support to the patient. So immediately what I done, I took a laryngoscope, put an endotracheal tube into his trachea because the patient is not breathing, and connected to Boyle's machine. Boyle's machine is the machine which gives oxygen. So from Boyle's machine, from the cylinders, oxygen comes to the bag, and we squeeze in so that the lungs get the oxygen. So I put the endotracheal tube, connected to the machine, and started squeezing the bag. I could not even squeeze the bag for a millimeter. That means there is some. So I just checked the machine all around. Is there any problem with the circuit? Nothing was there. And I thought, there is a manufacturing defect of the endotracheal tube. I removed the endotracheal tube. I saw everything is fine. I throw it off and I took a new one, the patient. But again, I squeezed the bag. Nothing was going in. That means the patient's heart, it is sinking, but it is there. But the breathing, the oxygenation of the tissues are not there. That means I need to, at any cost, give oxygen to the patient's lungs. I could not do that. Then I told the surgeon that there is a severe spasm of the trachea and we are losing the patient. Because I need to tell to the surgeon. So everybody was in a panic situation. Then one of the operation theater technicians, he shouted saying that, sir, why can't we give adrenaline? You all know what is adrenaline. Adrenaline, why he shouted is, generally at the, I mean, any catastrophe happens in medical field, like patient dies, the final attempt is you give adrenal into the heart, intracardiac adrenal, so the heart pumps again. But in this case, the heart is still there. The pulse rate is there and heart is, the ECG is showing. So the major issue now is we need to ventilate the patient. We need to give breathing and oxygen to the patient, which we could not. But I remembered one thing. One thing struck to my mind during my anesthesia training, whenever there is a spasm in the trachea, put that adrenal into the trachea, not into the heart. So immediately, with the help of the OT technician, I could take the adrenal and put it into the endotracheal tube. Immediately, just like opening a door, the trachea started ventilating. So pulse rate has come up, heart rate has come up, patient saturation has come up, and everything was fine. I asked the surgeon to continue with surgery, complete the surgery. Then afterwards, happily, patient got recovered and went into the post-operative ward. So after 1 or 2 hours, till now, the story is good. 1 or 2 hours, I went outside and saw a few people standing just beside the patient's room. I thought something again might have happened. So I went there. I saw that people are in a very happy mood. The surgeon was there. Surgical team was there. Nurses were there. Patient attendants were there. And I saw them. I saw all of them applauding the surgeon. They're saying, you had done a wonderful job. You've done a wonderful, surgery during that critical period. So you are the savior of this particular patient. I was astonished. Surgeon was seeing at me, but he could not even say that he's also our team. Actually, he's the main person who did all these things because he's an anesthetist. He knows how to resuscitate the patient. We were losing the patient and he helped us. But my name was never mentioned. It shocked me. It was like, big shame for me. What am I doing? So this happens a lot of times, but this was a very, very serious feeling felt by me and thought that, no, I think I should think differently. There are two issues here. One is, there was a catastrophic event, critical incident, where I helped the patient to come out of that crisis. I made the patient live again. But there is no applause, there is no concern, there is no, appreciation for me. Second thing is, what is this surgery? This surgery is done on a degenerative joint. That means degeneration is basically a normal, natural aging phenomena. So what happens is, in between the two bones, there's a cartilage. Cartilage is lost so that the bone rubs against each other and you get pain. For that, a major surgery is suggested for the patient, and there is a danger of, this sort of anaphylactic reactions or any other complication can happen. So there are two issues to change in my life. Then I thought I should not be continuing anesthesia. One thing. Second thing is I need to see that, is there any other treatment for such type of, chronic degenerative, non-disease, painful conditions. So I researched a lot. What are all the other things? Because it's a natural phenomena where patient gets this cartilage lost, where this patient gets a knee joint pain, shoulder pain, or spine pain. I need a natural solution for that. I researched a lot and found out there was a beautiful treatment which has already got the licenses, which already got permissions from all the medical boards. Whether it be FDA or ICMR. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm talking about the regenerative medicine, regenerative therapy, which can give rise avoiding all these major surgical procedures. Then I took up this treatment. I went to my orthopedic friends and asked them, this is what I want to do. Because, I have seen so many surgeries. Because as an anesthetist, I used to give anesthesia for almost like 15 to 20 surgeries every day. So why to unnecessarily subject a patient for such a big surgeries? Can we have something else? This is already there. Then all these my friends, they laughed at me, they mocked me, saying that no, this won't work. This is of no use because surgery is a big procedure. So that can't, this regenerative therapy can't replace the surgery. This is what they told. But still, I did not lose my hope. Then what I did is, I started practicing this. I stopped my anesthesia. I asked my wife that I'm stopping anesthesia. I want to do pain management or this regenerative medicine so that no, I be happy for myself and do good for the public so that no, all these complications can be avoided. She said, no, don't do that. You are good as anesthesiologist. You did MD anesthesia. Don't take the risk. But I never listened to her. I started doing this one. I continued. Initially, there was a lot of, skeptical thoughts that no, whether this is going to work or not. Whether if it doesn't work, what will happen to me? What my career would be? Whether I'll go back to anesthesia or no, I have to search for something else, some other business. But 2 months of the practice I started in 2017, 10 or 15 patients, I treated with this regenerative therapy. I got the result. In that result, almost like 90% success of all these chronic degenerative conditions, all these patients who have come, who have been advised for surgery, they come to me with a lot of belief that, no, this doctor treats the joints without a surgery. Then I could get a 90 to 95% success. Then I never look back. So now, ladies and gentlemen, I want to tell you that there is a new innovation. This is not a very new. It started somewhere in the 1960s. But no, it's got trampled. No one has got it, into the practice. Never it got popularized, but I did that. I did that. It was there. It's not invented by me. There is no innovation by me. But it's there. But boldly, against all odds, I got it into the practice. Now, today, just the knee joints, who are being advised for knee replacement surgery, I have done around 60,000 knee joints with this regenerative therapy named as PRP. Platelet-rich plasma. But the journey is not that simple. It's full of hurdles, full of threatening calls, full of, mocking me, laughing at me, saying that now you're cheating the people and all. I said, this has got a license since almost 30 years. It's a small injection, taking the blood from the patient, processing it, extracting the growth factors, and injecting at the part which is worn out or which is damaged or which is at the trouble. So in knee joint osteoarthritis, what will happen? It is the cartilage that is lost. Nothing else. Everything is fine. So increase the cartilage thickness so that there will not be any more rubbing of the two bones and patient comes out. If there is a shoulder injury, there is a small ligament tear or a tendon tear, you can inject these growth factors. The PRP consists of growth factors. The growth factors into the area where there is damage, it completely heals it. This is what I have proven. This is already there. I took it as a challenge and proven. So a lot of hurdles, a lot of, difficulties I faced in today. Today also we are facing a lot of problems because, we are trying to transform the lives from, surgical to non-surgical for all these chronic degenerative conditions. I'm not talking about disease, non-disease conditions. So there are lots of conditions where we can use this PRP. Lots of difficulties are there during my journey, and lots of difficulties we have come across. This is because, I followed my instincts. I followed my instincts. One is, I need recognition. People should identify me as a doctor. That is one. Second thing is, I can do good to the patients. I can do good to the patients not getting any complications or side effects of the surgery. So this is what I've taken up as a challenge. Today, I could do, and I have trained more than 5,000 doctors. All are practicing. I see them, they practice ethically and also do good to the patients. So 5,000 odd I have trained every day in my center now. There are at least 10 doctors who get trained. Whether it is anesthesiologists, some orthopedic surgeons are also there who are getting trained. So now the change has happened. There is a transformation which has happened. People are liking, the orthopedic surgeons are also liking that. No, why to do a big surgery on them? And you know, if complication occurs, no, it's a big trouble for him also. So this how the transformation happened in terms of this regenerative therapy. And now it is picking up now. It is everywhere in India now. In the South India, it is very much there. People's demand is non-surgical therapy. So people asking the orthopedic surgeons that surgery we all know, but what about this PRP? What about this regenerative therapy? Why can't you do this? That's why it is propelling or forcing the surgeons also to do the PRP. This is what we have done. This is what the sources which are there already in the medical fraternity, which I have come up, taken up into my practice. Now, a lot of doctors are practicing. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a big innovation. The final lesson, final summary I want to give is, no, you follow your instincts. Don't be in a comfort zone. You have something in mind. 1,000 times, you think about it. Take suggestions. Finally, whatever you want to do, you do according to your passion. If you are in the comfort zones, you will never come out. I wanted to be in a comfort zone till that incident happened. But I came out of it. That's why today I could see, you know, I have done something to the society. I've done something to the doctor's fraternity. I've done something to myself. So this is the lesson I want to tell you. And this is my experience. So all of you, I think, might have learned about it. And I want all of you to pursue such type of passion, such type of new things in your life. Everybody is having a new thing in you. Just explore it. Bring it out, and so that you can be a unique person, and you can be a unique person helping the society. Thank you very much.